again, we welcome you to St. Luke's this Maundy, Thursday evening. We're happy that you are here joining with us. And as usual, there is a bulletin on our website if you would like to download that and follow along with the readings, the prayers, and the singing. Our opening hymn now is God is Love and Where True Love Is.
from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read together Psalm 116. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I call upon him. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah.
Reading from Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth. I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus knew his hour had come to depart this world. In the past few days, he had entered Jerusalem in triumphant and scripturally fulfilling fashion. Hosanna, Son of David! Save us, Son of David! He had been teaching in the temple to crowds the likes of which Jews hadn't seen in the temple for a very long time. He had been overcoming Pharisaic challengers, healing, inspiring, and controversially teaching of the kingdom of God. Now he knows his time has come. This time has been known since humans fell from grace in the garden. As glorious as the past few days have been, Jesus knows he is about to be rejected and will suffer and will be killed. As Bishop N.T. Wright tells us, Jesus knows his work of preparing the world for God to be king is almost over. So what does he say to his disciples at this time? John writes, Jesus loved his own who were in this world. This world, the one in which Jesus is to be despised, rejected, denied and abandoned, misunderstood, and yet he loved them to the end. This world, the one that is about to be changed forever. This world that needs these beloved disciples to follow Jesus and do their part by suffering, experiencing rejection, and yet bearing witness to the story, the message, the life of Jesus. Jesus saw his disciples as those who, when he called them, responded and gave up everything to follow him. He loved them to the end. Jesus knew that God had led him to those he chose. God sent the disciples to Jesus. God had delivered all things into his hands. The disciples, the temple, the Pharisees, the Romans, rulers, and all people. They would all participate in fulfilling the scriptures and the making of God as king of this world. Jesus, in every moment, every word, every way, gives us an example of what God's kingship will be. It looks like something that the disciples never expected. Jesus takes off his outer robe and begins to wash their feet. The disciples are stunned, to say the least. Jesus teaches them that unless he humbles himself, they will not be able to teach from humility. Unless he serves them, they will not know how to be a true servant to others. To understand Jesus' lesson on serving, they must learn to keep God and others first in their hearts. This means obedience to God, listening for his voice at all times, and thinking of others first. Jesus was showing them and us unconditional love. Unless he makes himself vulnerable and always follows God's will, they will not have courage through faith. After washing the disciples' feet, Jesus asks, "Do you know what I have done for you?" In that moment, could any of the disciples possibly comprehend that they were part of another episode that they would later write about, and that it would remain in the hearts and minds of all of God's children for all time? As impressed or confused and grateful as they may have been at that moment, were they conceiving at all that Jesus was preparing this world for God the Father to have dominion over it as never before? Jesus is about to set free all people by his death and resurrection, free to be children of God. Jesus knows his work is nearly finished on earth, and that these 12 chosen have their roles to play in the continuation of God's reign on earth. Jesus knows that the messages God sends him to deliver of love one another, the Beatitudes, his miracles, his death and resurrection are the truth and will live in the hearts and minds of humans forever. And therein lies the kingdom of God. A kingdom where servants are not greater than masters, nor messengers greater than those who send them, but that those who serve will be exalted, those who are sent will be accompanied by the sender. It is the disciples' work, as well as ours, to continue what Jesus started, to restore humankind to full fellowship with God. As we dwell on this earth in full fellowship with God, everything on earth changes. Imagine this world and how it would be today if Christ had not been born, lived among us, rose and died, and rose from the dead. Jesus tells the disciples and us, "If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Today, we are as the disciples were, blessed when we serve others. Blessed by God as he reigns in our hearts and minds. Blessed by God through the other whom we serve. And blessed by God through the eyes and the smiles of others. Blessed by God through relationships whom we serve. And blessed by the humility and the love boiling up in our hearts. Now the Son of Man has been glorified. And God has been glorified in him. By washing their feet and teaching about humility and servanthood through his actions, God is glorified. Jesus is fulfilling Scripture, accepting his Father's will, and will soon be rejected and suffer at the hands of the unbelievers. It is God's will that the mocking and the rejecting, suffering, and dying of his Son will serve his purpose of establishing his kingdom in the hearts and minds of all humankind. Jesus is bringing great honor to God, enabling God to be king over the whole world. Dietrich Bonhoeffer believes God sent his Son into the world and brought him back from death to stand between us, each and every one of us, to be a part of our relationships with one another and with God. Are we capable of forgiving, accepting, embracing, loving one another without Christ? Christ being there to enable us? If Christ were between you and another, would he have done his duty for God if we only tolerate others? This changes all people for all time. When we believe and open our hearts to God through Jesus, we will live in the kingdom of God in the here and the now. When we make that change, in that moment, all that is around you, all that you touch and smell, all that you see and hear, all that you taste, changes into the kingdom of God. That moment is God's moment. This hour is God's hour. God will glorify his Son and thereby himself. By raising him on the third day, as prophesied, his Son immediately, and with no shred of doubt remaining, becomes the Messiah. God's kingdom begins to grow with his Son achieving his Messiahship, fulfilling all scripture and all that God promised. Little children, Jesus said. To Jesus, who having existed through the ages, through creation and through the Old Testament, the disciples are but children in age, in experience, in knowledge of heaven and earth, in faith, and an understanding of the power of God's love. The disciples and we have just been taught in a way only Jesus can teach. Taught to think God first, serve others first as directed by God, and to grow in his love, understanding, humility, and the knowledge of God's kingdom. Live it. Teach it. Give it away and prepare to grow in it. Jesus then says, love one another. How can we go wrong? We cannot love without God. We cannot perceive or understand anything in this creation without God making it possible. The love of God is not the same as the love of this world. Our reality now, it is that we are living in God's kingdom, and we are free to think about it, embrace it, live into it, or even turn our backs on it. God's love is for all children. By loving one another, Jesus tells his disciples and us, everyone will know a disciple of his by their love for one another. They will be an example to all the world, just as we are an example by loving God with all our heart, all our mind, and all our soul, loving our neighbors as ourselves. As C.S. Lewis said, you are not a body with a soul. You are a soul with a body. All souls belong to him who sent us, the Creator, God. To what purpose did God send you into the world? We are made by God, and we are sent by God. We are tasked by God, and we are loved by God. Thank you, Jesus.
Deacon Eric. Under normal circumstances, at this point in time, the deacon and I would remove our stoles, gather up a towel and a basin and a pitcher of water, and invite folks from the congregation to come forward to have their feet washed. This is not a normal time. And so we're setting aside that part of our service today because of the coronavirus distancing between ourselves. But it's a sign that we set aside the who and the what we are, the trappings of our offices, to remember that we are all of us servants of one another, no matter how highly we think we are or actually are. We are people who serve one another. So even though we cannot this year, under these circumstances, share in the washing of feet, we want to assure you that you are loved by all of us and served by all of us, and that we are all of us in this together, no matter where we are this very special evening. Would you join me now in the historic words of the Nicene Creed as we say what it is that we believe? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray together. Beloved God, we love you, for you have heard our cries.
And therefore, we will call on you as long as we live.
As you delivered our ancestors from slavery and led them to a land of promise and plenty,
liberate all who are captive or oppressed, and bring them to a place of abundant life.
As you saved your people from death by the blood of Passover Lamb,
redeem us from sin and death through Jesus Christ, our Passover.
As Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, stooped down to wash his disciples' feet,
teach us to love and serve one another with Christ-like compassion and humility.
As Christ the Lord has given us the gift of new life and fresh starts,
help us to share with all who need the gifts we have received from you, loving and serving one another in your name.
As Christ Jesus has given us a new commandment to have love for one another, we give thanks for organizations and first responders that are offering relief and humanitarian aid in these fear-filled weeks and months. We pause to offer our own prayers for all who call upon you. Beloved God, we love you, for you have heard our cries.
Therefore, we will call on you
Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Trusting in the steadfast love of Jesus Christ, who has delivered us from sin and death, let us confess our sin. Lord Jesus Christ,
how well you know our hearts, and still you love us.
You have loved us
to the end.
We have denied you,
and we have denied our calling to serve one another.
We have betrayed you,
and we have betrayed your commandment to love one another.
Pour out your Spirit of grace upon us.
Teach us to love and serve you faithfully,
and to love and serve one another
by the example that you have set for us.
In your holy name we pray.
Amen.
Now the Lord Jesus Christ has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. Now the promise is fulfilled, and love's redeeming work is done. We are forgiven in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Once again, we do welcome you here to St. Luke's. And at this point in time, I really recommend, because it's very effective, that you reach out to those you love, those you haven't seen for a while, and either text or email or whatever social media you use, share with them the peace of Christ. It really is meaningful, and it's good to stay in communication one with another. I would remind you that tomorrow at noon on Good Friday, we are live streaming our service right from here. We're doing the Good Friday liturgy as it's found in the Book of Common Prayer. And that's repeated throughout the day if you can't join us at noon. On Saturday, Holy Saturday, we're using last year's celebration of the great feast, the Easter Vigil, and we invite you to be part of that. Since that is musically driven, it's kind of impossible for us to do that with the four good souls who are gathered here today. And then on Easter Sunday at 10:30, we invite you to come and share in the good news of the risen Christ and hear the story of Mary of Magdala. And we hope that you'll join us for those times together.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.